that tension and kind of like roll himself down onto the bench.
Keep going, come on. Six.
It's ready. At some point, it's like, okay, we have to create an adaptation that you were forcing to try and recover from. It's the theory of supercompensation. It's like, yeah, at the end of the day, you have to provide a stimulus to then overcome, to then create new tissue, that's to create adaptation. It's like
something you haven't been a little bit further than before.
Yeah, you have to overreach.
Yeah, overreach.
We have to try and overreach. At some stage, you can't just sit there and be comfortable the whole fucking time. It's like, we do have to create this overreach system. We're like, hard. It has to be difficult to then spike up, create some kind of tissue, essentially overreach you to the point where you can't recover, then make you recover. You go through an SRA curve, which is like your, it's basically your stress response. So we have to spike up new stimulus, we then go down fatigue, recovery comes up, and then we essentially become higher than we were before when we started the stimulus. And then we start again and again and again and again. Like, that's the principle of muscle growth. We have to create an adaptation all the time to then try and recover from.
My question now is, like, can you overtrain, and is it that easy to overtrain?
I think it's, so no. So here's the thing. I would counter that question with, like, it's not about overtraining, it's about under recovery. So it's not about like too much stimulus, it's not the ability to recover from the stimulus. And I think that's where people misappropriate like overtraining. It's like, no, you just not had a really stressful week and you can't recover. It's like, life is stress, training is stress, everything is
food is stress.
Food is stress. It's like, it gets to a point where it's like, you're just not doing enough to recover. At that point, you may need some, or you may be overtraining or over, whatever, overreaching from that side. Yeah. It's like, okay, now you need a deload or something.
So it's like the people that are doing like 7 training sessions in the gym plus like another session a day, but not prioritizing rest and not eating enough.
Correct, and that's where you'll generally see. So how work volume works is, work volume works, or volume in general works, on a bell curve. So bell curve is always like minimal effective dose, optimal, overreaching if we were.
Yeah.
And like, in theory, minimal effective dose and overreaching gives us the same result.
Yeah.
So when you get people who are doing like 7 sessions a week, or like just cooking it completely, a lot of the time you just bring them down to like 3 sessions a week.
Yeah.
And they get the same response, if not better, because they stop recovering.
Yeah.
And then they're like, oh, but I'm doing less, but I eat more food, I look better. It's like inflammatory markers are down. It's like, okay, because it's the same.
Yeah.
And then you slowly start taking the volume up till we find like optimal.
Yeah.
And then we have to overreach again. And when we get to that point of all the markers, like, okay, bring it back down.
Yeah.
And then you start again. And that's the principle behind it. It's like, a lot of people think they're doing a lot more than they are.
Yeah.
That's the other side. It's like, everyone's doing a lot, but like, what is effective?
Yeah.
We've done 2 exercises, and like, I'm poked. Yeah. It's like, not many people can create the amount of tension or the amount of intensity that needs to be there. So a lot of people do a lot of work, but it's not effective,
like,
work.
Junk volume.
Yeah, to use the term, like, it's like junk volume.
How do you create an adaptation from that, like the stimulus? Because they're so used to doing that amount of volume, there's no progression because they're probably doing too much volume. So the only way they can really progress from that is adding more volume. And then so that's why we have to bring them back to minimal dose, to allow more recovery, to drive performance, get more in a performance base in terms of like load and numbers, from less sets or less volume with more rest.
A lot of that time will teach them how to start working harder.
Yeah.
It's like, they've got less work to create effective stimulus from. So it's like, most people are then like, oh, I feel really good, I can push harder. It's like, yeah, you're now not wasting the energy.
Yeah. Doing junk volume.
Junk volume, yeah.
Already a little bit taxed, so you get into it first, like 4 reps, like, oh, this isn't that heavy, and then all of a sudden you hit 6 and you're like, oh, taxed. Going. Yeah. perfect. Nice, bro. Good, bro. Yes. Let's go. Good work, bro. Good. Good. Yes, that's a better rep. That's just James' kryptonite.
It's my kryptonite. Blondes are my kryptonite. They usually ruin my life.
It's like a shark.
It's like a shark.
I can sense when one's around. I just know one's around. That sounds so derogatory, but I can just tell when there's blondes around. It just like amps me up. I'm obsessed.
Little blonde radar.
Hey?
Little blonde radar. Flip that all around. Yeah. Getting good, a nice stretch through the rhomboids here, letting that scapula move around the ribcage. So retract, protract right around in the big stretch, then draw. Perfect. Nice, James, let's work, mate. Good, there we go. That's perfect form. Let's go again. There. Good. That was much heavier. Made that heavier.
Good. I want you to take a breath at the bottom for me. So hold in the stretch, breathe into my hand. There we go. Now pull. That's better. Go again. Breathe. Yep. Good. Use that breath to lengthen. Good. Two more. Pull hard. Good. How much I hate this session. What's this, exercise number 4?
He's saying, thank you, Matt. I appreciate you bringing me today. Yeah. I really needed to die.
It's like just bending me over the bench. You might as well have just like...
Just shoving a pineapple up his ass.
Just, why pineapple?
Because it would hurt.
Yeah, but like...
Imagine the spikes.
Yo, I'm not worried about the spikes.
The girth of it
is what's concerning.
It's destroying. Yo. Soul shattering.
What if it's a blonde pineapple?
Hell no, no pegging allowed. No.
He thought about that for 2 seconds.
Oh, I was like, oh, where's that one going? Yeah.
Yeah.
So it's not like the question is obviously like doing off the rack or like a slight incline with a bench. So it changes the torso angle, which then like essentially affects the musculature slightly differently. You've got to take into account like gravity wins no matter what. So something like a bench, if it was a flat bench, you had like one knee on the bench and then like one hand on the bench, it's like you've got more stability, you've got more that you can kind of hold on to, there's more that's being stabilized, hence stability. So it's like you should in theory be able to like target different musculature and then allow for like a better position. Understand that every exercise has like a secondary and tertiary benefit to it. So it's like, okay, we don't just want to think hypertrophy. We want to think, what can I gain while doing this exercise to then benefit me in the long run to keep me doing the things that I like doing? So it's like, okay, Maddie's in a ipsilateral stance there. Ipsilateral stance is the same side, same leg. Ipsilateral stance is going to like help us resist lateral flexion. So lateral flexion is like essentially stop us from pulling. Like if the weight's pulling here, instead of pulling us down, we're going to have to use our left obliques to pull ourselves into position to then row at the same time. So it's like the secondary benefit of Maddie doing a ipsilateral dumbbell row is like we're getting a lot of oblique work in at the same time. Oblique work is pretty important if we're looking at like core function, pelvic function, like actually starting to be a functioning human. Then you've got like the other one of like a contralateral row, like a 3-point row. So it's like opposite leg, opposite arm. So this would be more like anti-rotation. It's like because we're having to resist the weight that's putting us in this direction, we're now using like the opposite oblique sling to have to function and again stabilize the pelvis. And like it's all secondary and tertiary benefits. But if you start looking at these as secondary and tertiary benefits to the exercise that we're using, you can eliminate a lot of like redundancies with an exercise selection. So instead of Maddie having to go and do extra oblique work because he's getting lower back pain, for example. He's like, well, I could just set him up on a different position in his row. He's a big boy. He's rowing fucking 60 kilograms. It's like, okay, 60 kilograms for him is actually challenging his obliques versus him side planking. So your side plank is beneficial and could be challenging for someone who can't row more than like half their body weight or just under half their body weight. It's like, understand like exercises need to progress. There has to be an index of exercises from like remedial to very advanced. And when you start looking at exercises within this index, you can start to piece together, like, again, the secondary and the tertiary benefits of every exercise.
We've got the vegetable stain. We've got a vegetable stain.
The vegetable stain is like... The idea behind it is like I'm hiding the vegetables in the spaghetti sauce. So it's like I fucking hated vegetables. Okay, so it's like my mom used to grind up vegetables and put it in my mac and cheese or my bolognese sauce or whatever it was, so that I would just eat the pasta or the bolognese. It's like I didn't know I was getting vegetables because my mom was hiding it in the sauce. It's like that's exactly what we're doing with these exercises. Like clients and all of us just think that we're doing an exercise and moving weight from point A to point B. It's like, well, it's actually the vegetables hiding in the spaghetti sauce, those secondary and tertiary exercise or benefits of the exercise are sitting in the sauce, if we were.
Good way to get abdominals in, because whether you're a gym pop client or an advanced athlete, bodybuilder, unfortunately it gets missed a lot. People don't want to do the abdominals. So one way is to incorporate into functional movements like that that requires stability through the core and strength through the obliques and that to create stability so you can perform the exercise. It is. Session is left side.
Yeah, you're talking to your elbow. So it's like, I guess a little tweak now, like with your curls.
Yeah.
So I would probably go single arm.
Single arm?
And I'd go single arm, and like, because we both have got really shitty external rotation and shitty carry angle. So carry angle is like the angle in which, or the distance in which the arm goes away from the hips. Like it's supposed to be there so that when we walk, our arms don't necessarily like bump into our hips. But you can see like my carry angle is pretty pronounced, and so is Maddie's, and like most bodybuilders will be. And like part of that could be structure, and part of that could be like really shill external rotation. The problem is like if we go and do a bicep curl now, it's like if I curl from here up, it's like gravity goes straight down. Gravity doesn't change. Gravity pulls straight down. Now the problem is the tension of the fibers in my bicep are not running straight down. You can see that they're running at like an oblique angle. So the problem is if I go and curl now, it's like I'm putting a lot of pressure in my elbow joint and essentially like onto my brachial. It's like that's kind of, we don't want that. We want tension on the bicep. So all I'm gonna do instead, like I could go and use a cable would be effective. I'm just gonna do something really, really simple. And I'm just gonna lean over. And it's like now it runs straight down. All I'm gonna do is do that. And so gravity's gonna run in line with the muscle fibers, and the tension is just gonna be direct onto the fiber that we're trying to recruit. Instead of putting like unnecessary tension on joints, we can directly load fibers, get a sweet pump, and hopefully grow arms.
Yeah, 100%. I want to be out here at the moment.
Yeah, do something. So that's why. It's like, pull this lean, get some curls in. Still getting the benefit of like an incline curl, which is that to like recruit the lower traps. So like an incline curl is fully lengthened bicep position, but it also allows us or puts us in a position where we have to utilize our lower traps or lower rhomboids and lower traps to pull our scapula back and be in an effective position. It's like, that's pretty healthy for us. It's good for shoulder health. It's a good way to like, again, hide the vegetables in the spaghetti sauce, so like instead of lying on the floor and doing stupid fucking Y raises. I can just do incline curls. Again, get a sweet pump, work my lower traps at the same time. I'm just now kind of adding it all in this one direction, or this one bowl or mixture, as we kind of have spoken about quite a lot today.
Let's do it. How good's that?
Locked in. Check it again.
God, I hate this exercise. One day I'm gonna get a clean run at that where it doesn't hook and take my momentum. It's awkward trying to get that one, bro.
Yeah, it will be. It's very like mid-range delt.
That's it. Alright guys, are we on? We're live? It's a wrap for us today. I just want to thank James Mack for volunteering to die with me in this session. Emily got a little bit of taste of it. And then bailed, she'd had enough. She was just like, no,
I'm out of here.
You can die alone. But yeah, it was a good session. Posterior chain, like I said, it's, as you can see, at the moment, still pretty sweaty. It's a taxing session when you're lifting the weight that we do. But all in all, it's a good session.
Yeah,
I think James even felt like having a bit of a chunder there. Like,
there was one or two almost spew moments, I think. The difference behind this, like, it's high intensity. It's like intensity is one of the factors that we need to drive into certain phases, and like understand this is a very high intense session when done correctly. Yeah, the sets, there's not a lot of working sets, but the overall tonnage and the overall load that lands up being kind of moved and executed at the end of the day is what's going to cause growth, and it's there for that adaptation that we kind of spoke about. So I think that's the takeaway from this is sometimes less is more. When less is done with the pursuit of accuracy at a high intensity is, I think, the key factor out of this.
100%. And you got to remember, at the moment, I'm in the push phase. Food is high, drugs are in play. Trying to, obviously, recovery, sleep and that, everything's on point. So it's not a session you'd be attempting in a deficit or anything like that.
Definitely not.
So if you enjoyed this, you know the drill, guys. Like, subscribe, throw a comment down. If there's any questions you want to ask on the YouTube, put it on there for us to answer. Tell your friends, tell your mum, tell the next door neighbour. Keep this going. I'll try and create as much content as possible, especially leading into contest prep. So we're not too far away from that. And that'll be another journey in itself, watching me and having James push me to get leaner and leaner and get ready for stage. It's been 2 years, which is going to be exciting. At the moment, I've just got to prepare, get the weight up, and be in a position to start prep from a solid starting point. All right.
That's it.